DuMont's coverage of Bishop Fulton J. Sheen's Life is Worth Living. I'll not be seen tonight so that we can instead bring you Countdown. Whenever you are watching us, we are live at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, and as good as we think the show is at any time, at any venue, live, gives it a certain count the light bulbs drama that cannot be replicated. Republicans, the new no taxes party, now calling for tax increases, at least on the poor and the middle class. And our third story tonight, even as new data showing this country's middle class citizens are paying a greater percentage than is its wealthiest. GOP candidates, including Rick Perry, expressing outrage that tax rates on the poor and middle class are not higher.
We're dismayed at the injustice that nearly half of all Americans don't even pay any income tax.
Look, we know you're functionally stupid, so let me explain this to you, sir. The Americans he's talking about are mostly low-income earners who are below the minimum income level at which you get assessed income tax. But they still, in fact, do pay payroll taxes and gas taxes, as well as state and local taxes. Who's really not paying their share of tax? A new congressional analysis finds a quarter of this country's millionaires pay a smaller share than do many middle-class families. And a plan from GOP frontrunner Herman Cain would make things even worse. His so-called 999 plan, or 999, would create a flat rate system with a 9% tax on business income, personal income, and all sales. It's getting a lot of buzz because it's easy to remember for stupid media people. In fact, the number 9 was mentioned only 85 times during the GOP debate this week.
Remember, 999 plan.
999 plan.
I don't need 999.
His 999 plan.
Keep mentioning 999 and Herman Cain. I'm going to have to go back to him every other question.
Thank you.
999. The plan they could not stop talking about would nearly double taxes on middle-class families. That, according to a calculation by ABC News. But not only that, according to Bloomberg's Juliana Goldman, it would also increase the deficit.
Bloomberg government has run the numbers, and your plan would have raised no more than $2 trillion. And even with that shortfall, you'd still be slapping a 9% sales tax on food and medicine.
The problem with that analysis is that it is incorrect.
Waiting for him to show his math. Keep waiting. Good answer, Herman. He was also stumped when asked how his plan would apply to things like American products that had international components, saying he, quote, doesn't know. The plan has earned scorn from economists on both sides of the aisle. Bruce Bartlett, a conservative who worked in both the Reagan and George H.W. Bush administrations, writing in the New York Times that, quote, the Cain plan is a distributional monstrosity. The poor would pay more while the rich would have their taxes cut. That's the idea. Even the Cain campaign's own economist saying the 999 plan, quote, wouldn't be the one I picked. So who came up with such crap? In fact, it was not crafted by an economist at all, but supposedly by a Koch brothers-affiliated financial advisor from a Wells Fargo branch in Ohio. And I say supposedly because, as widely noted on the internet today, a 999 tax plan, flat 9% taxes on three types of income, has existed since 2003 in the online game SimCity. We got a guy running for president with a total revision to the tax code that may be based on something somebody cribbed from a gamer. Joining me now to bring us back to reality, economist Robert Kuttner, co-founder of the American Prospect and senior fellow at Demos. Thank you for your time tonight, sir.
Well, it's going to take a lot to get back to reality.
Seriously, after all those mentions of 999. Right now, what would an increase on the tax rate of the middle class, doubling in the Cain case, what would that do to the economic foundation of the country?
Well, let's look at where the middle class has been. I mean, for 30 years, middle class incomes have been flat or declining. The things that allow you to be middle class, the cost of buying a home, the cost of sending your kids to college or going to college, the cost of health insurance, all of these have been going up faster than incomes. Since the collapse, the value of your house has gone down the drain, so you can't play the game of borrowing against your house. And then to frost the cake, they're going to sock you with a 9% sales tax on top of the sales taxes you're already paying to your state government. It's really loopy.
Yeah.
And it would just knock the stuffings out of the recovery, which isn't very robust anyway.
Yeah, the ABC calculation was those middle class families pay about 14% in federal income tax, and it would go to 27%, so it would virtually double what they were doing. Is the trick here that this has any kind of support, particularly among anybody making less than $4 million a year. Is the trick here like the one that Ken Burns documented in Prohibition, that when it passed, everybody thought their own favorite alcoholic beverage would still be legal, and now everybody who looks at something like this says, my taxes are going to go down, my neighbors will go up, not mine.
Well, it really is just astonishing that something that is so crackpot gets taken at all seriously, and that this guy in the latest Wall Street Journal poll is actually at the top of the field. I think the one good thing about this is it's forcing people to take a close look at the details, and the more they look at the details, the more no serious person supports this thing. It's distributionally bad, mm-hmm. It's bad for the recovery, and it whacks the middle class, which has been whacked for three decades.
The Republican talk about half the country not paying income taxes, which is their aha, gotcha thing of the month. How accurate is it, and how effective a political argument has it become? And isn't it something like saying, you know, a quarter of us are not paying car insurance, and you leave out the fact that that's the quarter that doesn't drive?
Well, I think the 99 versus the 1 is a lot more effective.
Yes.
I mean, as you pointed out a moment ago, the people who don't pay income taxes don't pay income taxes because their incomes are so low. And income taxes on lower income people were phased down and then phased out as payroll taxes went up. But you take a typical lower income family or even a working class family, you know, they're paying 6.2% payroll tax. On top of that, they're paying 6 or 7% property tax. On top of that, even if they rent, they're paying the landlord's share of the property tax. Mm-hmm. They're paying sales tax. So there are very few people in this country who are paying less than 15% taxes. And so now you're going to whack them with 9% income tax on everything and 9% sales tax on everything, including groceries and medicine. No exemptions, no deductions, their first dollar taxes. So it's a big tax increase, and it's just astonishing when you think about it that the Republican front runner, at least this week, is a guy who's advocating a tax increase on most Americans.
Bob Kuttner, the senior fellow at Demos, co-founder of the American Prospect, did bring us back to reality, and we thank you kindly for doing so.
Happy to be here. Thank you for bringing us back.
Try when I can. Remember the Florida Republican who wants to switch back to the electric chair because he thinks lethal injection is too humane? Turns out he also doesn't know crap about movies. Worst persons ahead on Countdown.